grace and the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Thank you for joining us for worship on this Sunday morning. In the flow of the church year, this is technical difficulties. Come on. Checking. 1, 2, 3, 4. We're not on. I'm sorry.
Not his fault.
In the flow of the church year, this Sunday is lifted up as Transfiguration of the Lord Sunday. It's always the Sunday before the season of Lent. We're journeying with Jesus and Peter and James and John up the mountain where Jesus is transfigured before us. So the theme of Transfiguration flows through our prayers and music and in our sermon today, and we enjoy the mystery of the Transfiguration of Jesus. Thank you for joining us for worship. It's good to be together. So as I said, Wednesday is Ash Wednesday and begins the season of Lent. Join us on Ash Wednesday. This is in your papers, and it's a preparation for that service. We will be here at 7 o'clock on Wednesday evening outside. So it's going to continue to be winter, so be prepared for that. And take a look at this service in preparation for your Lenten discipline and for Ash Wednesday. Psalm 51 is a traditional psalm for Ash Wednesday. It's printed here. And I encourage you to read it, to ponder it, to pray it, and then follow the directions and maybe be inspired to write your own prayer of confession for Ash Wednesday for the season of Lent. If you do, and if you wish, you can bring those with you to our Ash Wednesday service. There will be a fire burning, and there'll be an opportunity just to burn your prayer, a symbolic act for Ash Wednesday and the start of the season of Lent. So join us as we begin a new season of Lent and a new spiritual discipline in Christ. It's good to be together this day. Thank you for joining us. Dirk is our duty elder.
Morning, everyone.
Morning.
My name is Dirk Grove. I'm the duty elder for this week. And for any reason you can't get hold of Pastor Mark or the church office, my telephone number is listed in the bulletin, so please feel free to give me a call. We have a few announcements this morning. First one is the March newsletter deadline is this Friday, February 19th. Please submit articles to Linda Hagee, who's the editor, at your earliest convenience. You can check your bulletin for Linda's email address. If you haven't done so already, please pick up an annual report from the Narthex on your way out of church today. There is another announcement. This is the call to the regular semi-annual congregational meeting, which also is the reason that you'll want to get that annual report and read it prior to the meeting. Okay, by authority of the session, a meeting of the Congregation Corporation will be held in the sanctuary on Sunday, February 28th, 2021, immediately following the 8:30 a.m. morning worship. It'll begin at approximately 9:45 a.m. To receive the year 2020 annual reports of the Church Operating Fund and the Mission Organization Missionary Fund Treasurers, to review the 2021 Church Operating Fund and Mission Organization Missionary Fund budget, and to conduct any other old and or new business that properly may be brought before the meeting. And this comes from Denise Lockwood, the clerk of session. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Thank you. Please join me in our call to worship. The glory of God shines like a consuming fire. We have seen the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. The voice of God thunders like a mighty storm. Out of the cloud, God speaks. This is my beloved Son. Listen to him. We gather to listen, to repent, to worship and pray. Let us worship God. Let us walk in the light of the Lord. Let us pray. Speak to us, O Lord our God, and let the fire of your Spirit burn brightly in our hearts. Open our minds to receive the wisdom of the law, the hope of the prophets, and the life of the gospel. Jesus Christ, your living word. Amen.
Again, given our COVID restrictions, we're not singing, but there's these two beautiful hymns included in our worship service, and I encourage you to ponder them and pray the words and focus on our Lord Jesus Christ, beginning with Fairest Lord Jesus. We gather here recognizing the light and the grace and the love of our Lord Jesus Christ. We gather in his presence. And when we do, we're mindful of our own unworthiness, our own sinfulness. And it's very important that we take a moment to confess, to ask again for forgiveness and mercy. If you're comfortable standing, please stand and join me in our unison prayer. And importantly, please continue in a time of silent confession. Let us pray. God of all glory, beauty, and grace, we have tried to hide from you, to hide our faces, to hide our sin. Yet you have never hidden your love for us. We have tried to search for you in our minds, in the clouds, on mountaintops. Yet you have already revealed yourself to us in the face of Jesus Christ. Forgive us and transform us so that our lives may shine with your glory, beauty, and grace through Jesus Christ our Lord. In Christ, amen. My friends, the light, the beauty, the power of Jesus Christ shines in our lives, in our world. Remember, proclaim, in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. In Jesus Christ, we are saved. In Jesus Christ, we are redeemed and gathered and blessed. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. Thank you.
This morning's responsive reading is from Psalm 50, beginning at verse 1. The Mighty One, God the Lord, speaks and summons the earth from the rising of the sun to where it sets. From Zion, perfect in beauty, God shines forth. Our God comes and will not be silent. A fire devours before him, and around him a tempest rages. He summons the heavens above and the earth that he may judge his people. Gather to me this consecrated people who made a covenant with me by sacrifice. And the heavens proclaim his righteousness, for he is a God of justice.
Amen. Thank you. Our scripture readings continue with 2 Corinthians. The Apostle Paul was not on the Mount of Transfiguration with Peter, James, and John, but he probably heard about this famous, powerful story. And we think there's allusions to the Transfiguration in this passage, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, beginning at verse 3. So read along with me, so open your hearts to this word of Holy Scripture. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, beginning at verse 3. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not preach ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God said, "Let light shine out of darkness," made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. Amen. And for this Transfiguration Day Sunday, that famous story this year from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 9, beginning at verse 2, the Transfiguration of the Lord. Open your hearts, hear again this beautiful story. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him, and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There, Jesus was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And there appeared with them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it's good that we are here. Let us put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah." He did not know what to say. They were so frightened. Then a cloud appeared and enveloped them. And a voice came from the cloud. "This is my son, whom I love. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they no longer saw anyone with them except Jesus. As they were going down the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone that they had what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. Amen. Thanks be to God. Transfiguration Sunday. I love this story. It's always this Sunday before the start of the season of Lent. Lent starts here on Ash Wednesday. So we return to this story on this Sunday every year. There's really five kind of touchstones, key points in the life of Jesus that we should know and remember and ponder and understand. The first one's not really Christmas, it's the baptism of Jesus. We talked about it earlier this season, we preached about it, the baptism of Jesus, the story of John the Baptist, vital story to understand Jesus. And this one is second, the transfiguration of the Lord. Jesus takes his inner core disciples, the three most important, Peter, James, and John, and goes up on a mountain apart, and there he is transfigured. The third event, we know, the crucifixion. The resurrection, of course, on Easter Sunday, and the ascension of Jesus, which is in the first chapter of the book of Acts. These five kind of hallmarks in the life of Jesus. Do you know them? Do you know their meaning? Do you know their power? The baptism of Jesus, the transfiguration, the crucifixion, the resurrection, and the ascension. Today is Transfiguration of the Lord Sunday. Jesus up on the mountaintop with Peter, James, and John is transfigured. I love that word. It's a Bible word. We kind of don't use that word in any other context. It's this day's word, transfiguration. It says his clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone could bleach them. And his face shone. There's mystery and mysticism and miracle in this story. What's happening here? Jesus lit up for the disciples to see, for us to share. Look on the face of this transfigured Jesus. Peter, James, and John are there. Probably, you would think, to see someone transfigured, terrified. They don't know what to say. What Peter says is kind of odd. But this event changes their life. I'm sure they remembered it. Peter has allusions to it in his writings in the New Testament. The transfiguration of the Lord. And then, miraculously, mysteriously, what happens? Moses and Elijah appear also. How does that happen? What a great story. Two of the greatest hits characters from the whole Bible, Moses and Elijah. And they represent what they bring with them, this whole flow of the Old Testament. They represent the law and the prophets. The law and the prophets are there with Jesus in the persons of Moses and Elijah. Wow. We know the story of Moses, the lawgiver, the writer in the legend of the church, of the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, and Moses is the one that leads the people. Moses is the one that goes up on the mountain and receives the Ten Commandments and comes down and realizes the people have gone crazy and breaks them. And so we have Ten Commandments Part 2, the story in Exodus. Check that out. Moses, the lawgiver. And Moses represents morality. In the Bible, the word law can be used for the word morality. We are called to be a law-giving, law-obeying people. We are called to be a moral people. How are you doing with that? Are you living a righteous life? Are you living a good life? Are you living a moral life? In Christ, are you living in the law? All this flow of law giving in the Old Testament appears on the Mount of Transfiguration with Moses and is affirmed in the ministry in the presence of Jesus. Jesus fulfills the law, and so do we in obedience to Christ. It's a law in Christ of love and compassion. How are you doing with that? Are you living a moral life in Jesus Christ? Elijah is there too. The first and one of the greatest of the prophets. Over half of the Old Testament is the prophetic books. And Elijah represents that whole flow and tradition and heritage. The prophecy of the Old Testament is not about future telling. The prophecy of the Old Testament is about living in the right way, the way that God has shown us, and following in the way of God. And the hallmarks of the prophet's message is the same across the whole library of prophets. It's about compassion for the poor. It's about living an authentic life, that your actions and your prayers are consistent with one another, that you do what you say, and you say what you do. And it's about believing and knowing and hoping that God is way ahead of us, and God will have the last word, a word that may be beyond our lives. It's a looking forward to the fulfillment of God's work. Here we are in the miracle of transfiguration on top of the mountain. We get to take a glimpse at this story with Peter and James and John, Moses, Elijah, and Jesus transfigured before us. What a beautiful story. So I'm thinking, so what kind of illustration, example, story can help us kind of grasp this mysterious story? It's a good question for you. What illustration would you use to think about transfiguration if you were preaching it? I came up with driving. When you learn to drive, the first thing that you have to do is learn the rules. My dad taught me to drive just in the neighborhood where we lived. We didn't go anywhere. We just went around in a circle. But you kind of have to learn the rules, right? You learn how the car works. You learn that's a stop sign. That's the really important one. You learn the speed limit signs. You learn the yield signs. You have to learn the rules of the road. That's Moses. That's the law. It all is foundational. That's where it starts. We are called to be a righteous people, to obey the roles. And then you learn to drive, and you can go where you want to go. You can have a destination. You can have a purpose. And now we have this wonderful technology that helps us get there without getting lost. Are you on the road that God has laid out for us? Are we on God's path? God's out in front of us. Are we going the right way? That's the prophets. It's all flowing ahead of us. And here we are on the Mount of Transfiguration. So my third driving story or illustration is a wonderful story from my mom. My mom passed away in April 2020. So my mom and dad moved to and retired to Myrtle Beach and bought a new house and lived down there. And you know how marriages work. So they kind of made a deal, right? My mom said, well, all the boys are in Pennsylvania, so if we're going to retire to Myrtle Beach, I want a new car. So she's got a Chrysler convertible. So she wanted a Chrysler convertible when she moved to the beach. That was her retirement gift. We always teased her about grandma driving the convertible. She loved that car. And then she kept up this life tradition. She always went grocery shopping on Thursday morning. And it was kind of her escape from dad. You know what that's like, right? So she continued that in retirement. She would go grocery shopping on Thursday morning in her convertible with the top down at the beach. And then she started this tradition at the beach. And they lived in Little River, which is just north of Myrtle Beach. And in that area, like most of the beaches on the East Coast, every block, there's a beach access. So the public kind of has access to the beach, and the beach isn't just private property. Well, in Little River, all those beach access spots are also little parking lots. In the summer, of course, it's packed full at 6:30 a.m. You can't find a place to park. But in the off season, you can drive right up to the beach and park. So every Thursday, every week, like clockwork, 10 o'clock, my mom would go grocery shopping. Then she would go to McDonald's, get her lunch, and then go and pull into one of these little parking lots, sit back, and just enjoy the ocean and the beach and have her lunch. She always had a McDonald's lunch. I was like, Mom, how about Chick-fil-A or Subway or something? Can we have that McDonald's? Just sit back. And it was beautiful in her little convertible, nice leather seats, put the seats back. Enjoy the view. That's what this day is. It's Transfiguration Sunday. It's just a pause. Before we begin the discipline of the season of Lent, before I hope you renew and go deeper in your own personal prayer disciplines, just pause and look at Jesus. Look at him on this Mount of Transfiguration. Just sit back and relax and look at Jesus and see him lit up, transfigured, his clothes dazzling white, his face bright with the glory of God. Just for a moment. It is, of course, you know, an anticipation of resurrection, but not yet. We have a long journey yet. Just pause, look at Jesus, see his light, his glory, his beauty, his praise, lifted up on the Mount of Transfiguration. Just dwell there a moment and listen. Because then you can hear this voice. This is my son. I love him. Listen to him. Amen. This affirmation of faith is a beautiful exaltation of Jesus from the Apostle Paul. If you're comfortable standing, please stand and join me. Philippians chapter 2. God exalted Jesus to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Thank you.
Jesus Messiah. blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel.
Amen and amen. Thank you all. It's a blessing. It's an honor. It's a privilege just to have a few moments of quiet time to say our prayers. You all come here with prayers on your hearts, with people who need prayed for today, who need a touch of grace. So let's do that. Pray for the people on your hearts. Pray for our church. Pray for our world. So please, center yourself. Be quiet in your own heart, comfortable in the Lord. Let us pray. The true light that gives light to everyone has come into our world in Jesus Christ. Lord, shine on us. You have come to us in glory. Now we come to you in prayer. We pray for your glorious creation. Drive away the destruction of pollution in our land and air and water. Restore the beauty of this world and help us to see it. Help us to live as people who cherish and treasure the precious gift of your creation. The true light that gives light to everyone has come into our world in Jesus Christ. Lord, shine on us. We pray for the body of Christ, the church universal, in every place, in every age, and here in this place. Open our hearts in faith. Enlighten our minds with the knowledge and conviction of your power. Strengthen us to hear and to proclaim the good news of the gospel. The true light that gives light to everyone has come into our world in Jesus Christ. Lord, shine on us. We pray for the people of every nation and for our nation. Show the nations of the world your vision of justice and the demands of the common good. Offer our leaders your mantle of wisdom and call them to lead with compassion. Give your people the blessing of peace. The true light that gives light to everyone has come into our world in Jesus Christ. Lord, shine on us. We pray for those for whom death is drawing near. We pray for the hungry. Feed those who are starving. We pray for the ministry of the Fairfield Food Pantry, Ruth's Harvest, the Gettysburg Soup Kitchen. Comfort those who are on our minds, who are suffering in body and mind and spirit. Especially, we pray for those who are suffering alone. We pray for a deep and profound healing from the destruction of COVID-19 quickly, Lord. The true light that gives light to everyone has come into our world in Jesus Christ. Lord, shine on us. We pray for those whom we love. Bless our families, sons and daughters, children, grandchildren, parents, grandparents, brothers and sisters, friends, neighbors, colleagues, people sitting in the pew next to us. Help us in times of trouble. Inspire us in times of abundance and success. Be near us when we are afraid. Calm us when we are anxious and stressed. The true light that gives light to everyone has come into our world in Jesus Christ. Lord, shine on us. Make us ready for the day when the world is transfigured, when all things will shine in the dazzling light of your glory through Jesus Christ. And maybe most of all, Lord, teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Enjoy one of the most beautiful and common tunes in our hymnal. Pray to the Lord, be thou my vision. Both here and at home, thank you for joining us for worship on this good Sunday morning. Please stand for our benediction. Happy Valentine's Day. Be grateful and give thanks to God for the love in your life. Peter was on the Mount of Transfiguration. It probably changed his life. And he has allusions to that experience in his writings. This benediction is from Peter. Open your hearts, open your hands, Therefore, my brothers and sisters, be all the more eager to make your calling and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never fall, and you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God. Amen.